नमस्कार, मायसेल्फ प्रोफेसर रमेश कौर, डीन एंड हेड कलानिधि डिवीजन, इंदिरा गांधी नेशनल सेंटर फॉर द आर्ट्स, एक्सटेंड ए वेरी हार्टी वेलकम टू यू ऑल टू दिस वेबिनार ऑन सेलिब्रेटेड पेंटर्स एंड फोटोग्राफर्स ऑन बंगाल एंड शांति निकेतन. ऑन दिस पर्टिकुलर थीम रिसेंटली वी हैव ऑर्गेनाइज्ड an exhibition in Kolkata during the event which was coincided with the Honorable Prime Minister's visit, and a number of events were inaugurated. The exhibition was organized in the National Library of India, Belvedere House, and based on that exhibition, because we feel that many people might be interested in these collections, and we thought of organizing this webinar, which will include an introduction to the exhibition and launch of virtual exhibition based on that Kolkata exhibition. And our colleagues who were involved in that, they will talk about various aspects of curation of that exhibition, like how conservation was done, how different material was curated. And above all, we have our guest speaker to speak more about on the topic. We have Professor Sanjay Malik, who is head of the Department of History of Arts and Principal Kala Bhavan, Vishwabharati Shanti Niketan. So welcome to Professor Malik, and thanks for your kind readiness in agreeing to our request to deliver this talk today on your topic of talk is comprehensive. Comprehending his relevance as a painter in the context of early Indian modern art in the context of Rabindranath Tagore. And I welcome our member secretary, Dr. Sachidanand Joshi, who is also chair of today's program. And with his blessings and guidance, IGNCA is achieving new heights. And in this online world, we have been constantly organizing events. Prior to becoming member secretary of IGNCA, he has served as a vice chancellor in University Thackeray University of Journalism in Raipur, and also he was the founding registrar and professor in Makhanlal Chaturvedi University of Journalism in Bhopal. Prolific writer, a very great human being. He has very lovely writings on current aspects of India in many current issues. So thank you, sir, for your kind presence and agreeing to inaugurate to this today's webinar. I am with my colleague, Dr. Achal Pandya, who is the head of Division of Conservation in IGNCA, a very well-known, internationally renowned conservation expert, and has been associated with ICROM and many international bodies, and has been helping many national international libraries in the field of conservation. He is also the post coordinator for the program in post PG diploma in conservation at IGNCA. We have another colleague, Dr. Sanjay Kumar Jha. He's a currently the head of our archive unit in Kalanidhi. My colleague, Dr. Brin Bangru, currently he is a regional director at center in Jammu. So I welcome you all, and many of the participants who might have joined first time, just few glimpses of various information regarding IGNCA and particularly Kalanidhi. And just a few things, what we have in our cultural archives, IGNCA, which is an autonomous body set up in 1987 under the Ministry of Culture, served through various divisions in different aspects of Indian art and culture. There are six major divisions. Then we have about nine regional centers. Kalanidhi, which is basically a resource center, which has all print, digital, microfilm, and different kind of cultural archival material in its possession have different units: print library, microfilm unit, manuscript unit, slide unit, cultural archives. And the special program in reference library is the acquisition of print personal collection of eminent scholar. We already have more than 24 in row. The cultural archive from which collection this exhibition was curated, and this is one of the largest cultural archival collection in India. We have several important personal collection, near about 45 in number. These collections have been divided into six major categories: literature, which we include Dr. R.C. Rangra collection, audio recording of interview with writers of Indian languages. We have Voice of Tagore, audio recording of Guru Rabindranath Tagore, 20 audio spools. Akhilesh Mittal collection, recordings of renowned Urdu poet Firak Gorakhpuri in 21 audio spools. And these have been digitized also. Then we have Vastu Silk. We have about 998 art objects in Lansdowne collection. We have Vinay Vahil collection of Ajanta Cave. We have Sambhunath Mitra collection of Terracotta temples of West Bengal. Then in the category of photographs, Chhayapatra, we have photographic collection. Eminent one is Raja Deendayal. We have glass plate negatives, his camera, studio objects. And that was displayed, the camera and the objects were displayed in this exhibition in Kolkata and was a special attention to the people. We have various other photographic collection, Cartier Vaishnav collection of photographs of important political leaders and event of pre and post independence India. We have DRD Walia collection of photographs. We have David Oldrich collection of photographs. We have photographs by Jyoti Bhatt and Raghav Kaneria. We have Ashwin Mehta's photographic collection. We have Martha Sharan's collection, Sunil Jana, Sambhu Saha, which is basically a collection of Guru Nanak Tagore. So exhibition in Kolkata were having Sambhunath Saha, Raja Deendayal and Sunil Jana and some Cartier Vaishnav collection in display. In music, we have a wonderful collection. We have a Krishna Swami collection, S. Natarajan collection, V.A.K. Rangara collection, Ranganayake Iyengar collection, and Dr. S. Venkatesh collection of Carnatic Music. We have several other collections. A special one is Elizabeth Bruner's mother and daughter's paintings. And some of the paintings of Rabindranath Tagore and Shantiniketan were displayed in this exhibition in Kolkata. Then we have some photographs of different UNESCO sites, R.P. Mishra collection. We have another very important and very big collection in Anand Kumara Swami collection, which has books, journals, letters, glass diary, photographs, artifacts and art objects. And some of the other collections we have acquired or we have collected from different projects, like our divisions undertake various kind of projects. And with these projects, we have puppets, we have worldly painting, we have rock art paintings, we have audio video, we have various kind of slides and number of other photographic collections. So we have a very rich and very high eminence collection in our repository. And recently we have added one very important collection, that is Mohan Khokar dance collection, which is very unique and very multi objects in this collection. And we have a visual collection other than cultural archive collections, more than 1 lakh visuals on different aspects of Indian culture, tradition, architecture, paintings, landscape, courtyards, monuments. So at IGNC, and as I mentioned, we have program PG diploma in conservation and in cultural informatics, on Buddhist studies, on preventive preservation, on South Asian studies, on digital library data management, on manuscriptology and paleography, on tribal arts and culture, and certificate course on documentary and ethnography making, folklore, Indian knowledge traditions, open access resource research methodology, screenwriting. Very soon we are coming out with some online certificate courses Today we have discussion with our member secretary, and he has approved the program's academic calendar for next year, and very soon you will see the announcement for 4-5 certificate courses online mode. So in this current situation, we found that online education is the most important. A very popular program, a book discussion under IGMJ Book Circle. We are also a nodal center of Ministry of Culture in helping documentation of preservation and access to documentary heritage under UNESCO Memory of the World program. We help in dossier making, submission, and we have undertaken a project mapping of archives in India recently. So a wide variety of activities in this place. You are welcome to use Kalanidhi resources. Nominal membership for week, it's free. For temporary membership, one month, 100 rupees, and 250 for students and 500 for individuals as an annual membership. Renewal is just half of that, and 5,000 life membership, one-time payment. So we have all kind of facilities. We have databases like JSTOR and EBSCO Humanities International Complete. Entire collection have been digitized, and you can have option to get digital copies and other things. So with these small words, we are also trying to work on language documentation. Recently with University of North Texas, we have started some program, and maybe we are working on some course, and certificate course was organized sometime in June, and advanced level course in February. So with these, I once again welcome you. Thank you very much. Feel free to contact us for any further information regarding Kalanidhi. And I will just like to just express my sincere thanks for all of you for joining this program. Now, I would like to request our member secretary to formally deliver the inaugural address and inaugurate the program. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Ramesh Gaur. Dr. Sanjay Kumar Malik, Dr. Achal Pandya, Dr. Virendra Bangaru, Dr. Sanjay Jha, Dr. Shilpi Roy, my friends from NEGD who are doing a great job in providing us this platform, and all the participants who have joined this webinar from different parts of the country. This is in fact a kind of a virtual inauguration of an exhibition which we displayed in the Belvedere House in Kolkata. As we all know, West Bengal, actually entire Bengal, had rich heritage and treasure of ancient times, and even in the modern times we had a great treasure of art and heritage. So those things were supposed to be displayed in a proper manner, in a proper fashion. This was the initiative of our Honorable Prime Minister, Maninee Shri Narendra Modi ji, that the treasure which belongs to West Bengal should have proper places to display, and it should have the larger outreach. We also know that Kolkata had some very beautiful iconic buildings which were not in use in present days, like the old currency building, which had a very prominent location, and it had its old historical importance. But in today's days, the old currency building was not in use. Like Belvedere House, which was supposed to be the library or something like that in earlier days, but it was not in use. It has a beautiful campus and a very sprawling campus, a very graceful building. So it was not in use. And Metcalf House also was in that kind of a shape. So, and of course, some galleries in the Victoria Memorial Hall. So there was a move to refurbish these buildings in their original style, just to maintain the grace and grandeur of those buildings, and to bring them to the use in a way so that the art lovers, the connoisseurs of art, and the students of art and culture can come and visit these places and get the feel of different kinds of art pieces and heritage available in our entire country. So that was the move, and under the leadership of the CEO for development of museums and cultural spaces, these buildings were refurbished and recreated, and Honorable Prime Minister inaugurated these buildings in the month of January this year. That was a very important function, and IGNCA was given the responsibility of displaying its treasure, which IGNCA had related to iconic personalities of West Bengal. They are not personalities of West Bengal, actually they all are international figures, but they belong to West Bengal, and so their collection, their heritage was supposed to be displayed in West Bengal Fest, and then it can be taken to different parts of the country. And that is how this exhibition was created. We know that we had IGNCA, as Dr. Ramesh Gaur has told you in his presentation, IGNCA has some of the beautiful collections related to different art pieces like Elizabeth Brunner and Sars Brunner collection. Their painting collection is remarkable. And in that collection, they have also created some beautiful pieces related to Gurudev, Sri Rabindranath Tagore, and the Shantiniketan. They are an absolutely fantastic work which have not been shown so far. So we thought that we would display those things for the benefit of public. We also have the iconic collection of Raja Deen Dayal, who was an ace photographer, and he displayed his creative ability in between 1845 to 1890, which we can understand when you did not have the sophisticated camera equipment, so sophisticated audio-visual equipments. In those tough times also, Raja Deen Dayal was supposed to be a person who created history for his work as far as portrait and the scenic beauty is concerned. So we also had a remarkable collection of Raja Deen Dayal, so that was also supposed to be displayed. We also had collection from Shambhunath Saha and Sunil Jaina, and all these collections had different kind of presentations to make. So we thought that it would be a very good idea that IGNCA create a few galleries of its collection in the Belvedere House, where we can display all these collections with their own grace and glory. So that that exhibition was created, and we have tried to display that entire collection there. And not only that, we have also tried to recreate like studio of Raja Deen Dayal. What kind of a studio this was? I think most of the young students of the art history may not even get an idea what kind of studios there used to be in the in the older days, in the ancient era. Because today, because of this digital technology, we have become very, very comfortable and friendly as far as photography is concerned. But those studios and those sets and everything, I mean, it is really a treat to watch. Similarly, the paintings which was created by these ace photographers, or the photographic collection, everything has been, I mean, they are top class and out of this world. So we thought that it would be a very good opportunity to showcase all these things at the Belvedere House. We all know that whatever art piece is created by a creator and an eminent artist is a piece of creation parallel to the piece of creation by God, because we know that the work of an artist is unparalleled. In fact, the artist himself or herself cannot recreate the thing which he or she has created. This is the kind of wealth that an artist creates. And West Bengal has been blessed with the presence of some of the greatest names in the world of history, in the world of art. And that is why this pious land, this blessed land should display all these things, was the idea. With that idea, IGNCA also took part in this exhibition, and we were fortunate to have a very good response from the audience, from the spectators. The audience was fantastic, the response was fantastic, and that encouraged us to bring out this virtual exhibition to display it on a larger platform. As we know that we all are going through a very tough phase, and especially Kolkata and West Bengal because of the recent cyclone, which is really very disastrous and very dangerous, terrific. We can understand what kind of pain and agony the people of West Bengal, especially from Kolkata and other places, are suffering. But in this moment also, we all are with them. We all are with those who have lost their lives. We all are with them who have lost their livelihoods. We all are with them who have lost their property, their things. Whatever best we can do to preserve those things, we would try to do. But this would also be an occasion to just see. We still have many good things with us, and we can move ahead with this. Natural calamity is unavoidable, and we have to face it with brave heart and strong willpower and commitment. And I'm sure that people of West Bengal are capable of doing that, because they have always been the leader of the intellectual leader of the country, and they have led it from the front. So they will lead this time also from the front. So this exhibition is only to showcase the kind of intellect, the kind of creativity, the kind of imagination we have in the state of West Bengal, and it should be shown to the entire world. One good thing about this online technology is that it reaches out to many at different places. Had it been confined to one place, only a few people belonging to that particular place would have been benefited. But now, because this is online, I can see 275 people already joined this webinar, and they I'm sure they are not only from Kolkata or West Bengal. They are from all parts of the country, and maybe a few from abroad. So this is the benefit of having this thing online, and we must understand the limitations of this medium. And despite that, my colleagues at IGNCA have tried to put up a great show in front of you. I must congratulate Dr. Gaur, Dr. Achal Pandya, Dr. Virendra Pangaru, Dr. Sanjay Jha, Dr. Shilpi Rai for putting up a great show, because all of them have worked very hard day and night to put up this show. We know that these all are precious objects, and to carefully handle them is a very challenging task. And they all have done that with their fullest ability and expertise. So with this also, I would like to request all those who are interested in either in art curation or in art conservation or in archival studies or in data management, they all can come to IGNCA or contact us through their emails or online, so that we can share what all we are doing in these fields. We are also developing IGNCA as a prominent institute for training and interaction. So we would request the younger generation to come forward and take the advantage of the trainings which we are going to offer and which we are offering, so that in years to come, we have a very bright young force to work in these fields. All of these are very specialized fields, and there is a great demand of qualified people to work in these fields. So with these words, I once again congratulate my colleagues at IGNCA. I welcome all the participants, and I inaugurate this exhibition. And I also welcome Dr. Sanjay Kumar Malik, who is from Vishwabharati Shakti Niketan, the house of Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. For us, it is like a pilgrimage. Whenever we go there, it is like visiting a pilgrim. So you are belonging to a blessed place. Nine blessings. I think this webinar is going to be a successful webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your kind blessings and inaugurating the webinar. This show at Kolkata could not have been possible without your guidance and wonderful leadership. So thank you, sir. And I want to just share that if you want to write to our member secretary about the ideas he has just expressed here, you can contact him at msignc@yahoo.com and can send your mail to him for the ideas he has asked to explore with all the participants. So we have a number of proposals to have this exhibition. Other like Shanti Niketan, we could not able to do it, but now Mr. Malik and Professor Chakravarti is very keen that we will do on some appropriate time. And there are a number of other requests. Even there is a request from Iran, on Dr. Abhay Singh. He has seen the details and he's saying, why don't you bring this? Because people are very much interested on Rabindranath Tagore in Iran too. So maybe this exhibition may travel internationally, but before it physically travel, we are traveling virtually. And what was the exhibition? Thank you, sir. Thank you for your kind blessing.
एक मिनट और लेना चाहता हूँ. मैंने अभी कुछ प्रतिभागियों का जो रिस्पॉन्स देखा, जो चाहते थे कि हिंदी में बोला जाए, मुझे 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 थोड़ा खेद हुआ कि मैं पहले इसको नहीं देख पाया. अगर पहले देखता तो शायद मैं अपनी बात हिंदी में भी कहता, तो प्रतिभागी मुझे क्षमा करेंगे. और मेरे बाद के जो वक्ता हैं वो थोड़ा हिंदी थोड़ा अंग्रेजी बोलेंगे तो ज्यादा बेहतर होगा. मैं क्षमा चाहता हूँ कि मैंने पहले नहीं देखा. अगर मैं पहले देखता तो शायद मैं आधी बात हिंदी में कहता. मुझे हमेशा बहुत अच्छा लगता है हिंदी में ही बोलना. तो बाकी जो मेरे पैनलिस्ट हैं वो अगर इस बात को थोड़ा ध्यान रखेंगे तो बहुत अच्छा होगा. बस इतना ही कहना चाहता
हूँ. हम चाहेंगे सर एंड में कंक्लूडिंग में भी आप कुछ बोलें और जो उनकी रिक्वेस्ट है हिंदी में उसे पूरा करें. So, thank you, sir. So, exhibition क्या थी? How it was developed? क्या object थे उसमें? किस तरीके की exhibit? किस categories में कौन photographs? क्या paintings थी? तो वो सारी की सारी details जानकारी मेरे colleague Dr. Sanjay Jha, जो कि हमारे archives के in charge हैं. मैं Dr. Sanjay Jha से कहूँगा कि वो आप अपना presentation हमें एग्जीबिशन के बारे में, उनके एग्जीबिट्स के बारे में पूरी जानकारी दें, जिससे कि सभी को पता लगे कि जो हम वर्चुअल एग्जीबिशन यूट्यूब पर अपलोड करेंगे उसमें क्या क्या ऑब्जेक्ट होंगे और किस तरह की जानकारी होगी. तो ओवर टू डॉक्टर संजय झा, प्लीज शेयर योर प्रेजेंटेशन एंड यू कैन नाउ स्पीक.
थैंक यू. नमस्कार. दिस इज इंडीड माय ऑनर टू बी प्रेजेंट हियर एंड आल्सो टू बी पार्ट ऑफ दिस इवेंट. दिस इज बिकॉज ऑफ ऑनरेबल Member Secretary's wonderful initiative to use the virtual platform for creating a public space for cultural dialogue. This is probably one of the best areas for one-to-one dialogue with a scholar and artist. Agency played a significant role to deliver several live talks, webinars, cities in the world, pandemic situations. Thanks to Dr. Sajnanand Joshi, the prolific writer and poet who understand the mood of the scholarly people. Throughout this period, he constantly in touch with the scholars and artists and encourage them to use this virtual platform. The idea of curating exhibitions at Belvedere House, National Library, Kolkata, was primarily mooted by Professor Joshi. The painting photographs were selected from 5 collections of cultural archive, culinary related to Shantiniketan and Bengal. The purpose of the exhibition is to complement the initiative taken by Honorable Prime Minister.
Sanjay, aap apna PPT nahi share karenge?
Ji ji, PPT bhi kar rahe
hain. Haan, PPT kar rahe
hain. Thoda sa background hi de. The purpose of this exhibition is to complement the initiative taken by Honorable Prime Minister towards reinvent, rebrand, reinvent, rehouse the collection as part of nationwide campaign to preserve India's culture, art, culture and heritage. The entire curation was academically supervised by Professor R.C. Gaur, internationally known information scientist and expert. IGNC curated 5 exhibitions under the title Celebrated Painters and Photographs on Bengal and Shantiniketan. It was spread in 14 rooms of Belvedere House. Dr. Gaur has already spoken about the something about the IGNC and its collection, but and he also spoke about the collection. But I would talk a little bit about the agency specialization in institutionalization of exhibitions by agency. Agency started the specific kind of multimedia presentation of the exhibition focusing a particular theme on the cosmic linkage or symbiotic relation of man with nature, IGNC redefined the purpose of exhibition with the putting of the thematic sequence with text, quotations, photographs, thoroughly researched. In IGNC, the exhibitions are organized in certain way that showcases India as a perspective in comparison with the other culture of the world. It mainly focuses on the art, tradition, literature, and other cultural elements, either reflected in the classical ancient text and any other tangible, intangible form of any religion. IGNC picked up these cross-cultural elements and related them with the Indian themes. And Honorable Prime Minister is inaugurating the exhibition. Bengal, the land of culture consciousness. Bengal has been cradle of culture, and its luminaries have taken the lamp of knowledge worldwide, winning deep admiration and fulsome appreciation. The Bengal Renaissance took place in undivided India's Bengal provinces over the way to socio-culture and spiritual reform movement during the 19th and early 20th century, whose impact spread all over India. IGNC paid tribute to Gurudev Tagore with this very special exhibition showcasing the original works of Hungarian mother and daughter. And they were spurred by a spiritual dream of Tagore way back to 1930. And set sail for India. Their portrayal of Shantiniketan and Gurudev's aura through their mystic visual aura touches may chords with the grace of their honesty. These are the exhibit displayed in the 14th rooms of Belvedere House. This is just a glimpse.
Aapka PPT display nahi ho raha hai.
Oh, it is not displaying. It's okay, sir.
नहीं आप एक काम करो, पहले पीपीटी खुला हुआ था ना, आप उसको शेयर स्क्रीन करो.
अच्छा से कर रहा हूँ सर, शेयर स्क्रीन करो. Now it is, I mean, you're able to see, sir?
नहीं संजय, एक काम करो कि वेट करो, मैं तुम्हारा.
आई थिंक नाउ इट्स कमिंग. देखो नहीं हुआ, नॉट सर, ये आ रहा है सर?
हेलो, नहीं आ रहा.
नहीं संजय अभी नहीं आ रहा, वेट करो आप. संजय आप वेट करो, मैं
ये करता हूँ सर, जस्ट मिनट.
हो गया
अब इसको F5 करो. क्लिक ऑन शेयर स्क्रीन, देन सेलेक्ट द योर पावर पॉइंट प्रेजेंटेशन, देन डू F5 इसको.
ये आ रहा है सर अब?
हाँ अभी आ रहा है आपको. फ्रॉम बिगिनिंग स्लाइड शो करो, फ्रॉम बिगिनिंग स्लाइड शो.
अच्छा अच्छा, या
अभी और आप आगे करिए
जी. ठीक है सर, यहाँ से
नहीं, अभी नहीं. आप ऐसा करो ना, स्लाइड शो पे क्लिक करके फ्रॉम बिगनिंग सेलेक्ट कर लो.
ठीक है सर,
अब स्लाइड शो करो
जी.
F5
जी. हेलो
यस
F5 दबा दो आप F5
S5 दबा दो S5 जो चले गए
F5 फंक्शन 5
हाँ ठीक है, अब काम कर रहा है, आप बोलना शुरू करिए।
ऑडियो नहीं आ रहा है
आपका? ऑडियो आ रहा है, आप सुनाई दे रहा है संजय, आपको सुनाई दे रहा है, आप बोलिए, आप प्रेजेंटेशन शुरू करिए अपना, आपको आवाज सुनाई दे रही है।
I'm audible sir?
Yes, yes, you are very much audible. आप बोलना शुरू करिए, आप प्रेजेंटेशन दीजिए, कंटिन्यू करिए अपना, कहां से करना है इसको?
हेलो सर, मेरी आवाज आ रही है?
हाँ संजय, आपकी आवाज आ रही है।
देखो कहां से है, मेरा प्रॉब्लम चल रहा है।
सर आपकी आवाज आ रही है, आप बोलिए।
सर मेरी आवाज आ रही है? सर
जी सर आ रही है आपकी आवाज।
हाँ हाँ ठीक है ठीक है। ये भारत के यशस्वी प्रधानमंत्री जी हमारे एग्जीबिशन को समर्पित कर रहे हैं राष्ट्र को, और ये जो ओल्ड बेबलेड हाउस है, एक आर्टिस्ट थे विलियम प्रिंसप, उन्होंने इसको स्केच किया था, और द न्यू रिनोवेटेड वन नाउ वी हैव। ऑन द ऑस्पिशियस डे ऑफ जनवरी 11, 2020, द ऑनरेबल प्राइम मिनिस्टर ऑफ इंडिया श्री नरेंद्र भाई मोदी जी इनॉग्रेटेड सेवरल एग्जीबिशंस माउंटेड एट बेबलेड हाउस विक्टोरिया मेमोरियल करेंसी बिल्डिंग। At Belvedere House, IGNC mounted 6 exhibitions. It dedicated this entire event to the intellectual, social, religious leaders and reformers and artists of the Bengal, ranging from Bhakti movement to the Bengal School of Painting. He chanted Amar Sonar Bangla before the beginning of the address. He further reiterated, when someone visits Bengal, his heart fills with the extreme joy looking at the cultural heritage of Bengal in the form of art and architecture written all over the day. He mentioned that the sacred soil of Bengal had always attracted him a lot. This event marked as the beginning of new possibility towards establishing, upgrading, preserving the heritage building as the public space. To match with the 21st century challenges, it is high time to reinvent, rebrand, renovate, and rehouse the entire collection of the museum. He said, today is the historical day of Bengal to begin the new era towards the conservation of art and culture. The new opportunity will be created to the advantage of tradition and tourism. This gallery of Victoria Memorial Hall will showcase Indian leaders like Subhash Chandra Bose, Aurobindo Ghosh, Raj Bihari Bose, etc. This gallery will be known as Biplabi Bharat. He indicated that the existing iconic museums will be upgraded to the international standard. In the first phase, the old museum will be refurbished. The layout of the exhibitions in the Belvedere House, and the exhibits, I mean all the exhibits displayed in 14 room that I've already told you. मुझे सुन पा रहे हैं सर?
हाँ बिल्कुल, बोल रही है, बोलते रहिए, आपको सुनाया जा रहा है।
जी जी, this is very iconic image. I mean, this painting was made by Elizabeth Booner, and it's very iconic painting. The both his mother and daughter, extremely talented daughter Elizabeth Booner, do come to India in search of speciality and Indian wisdom of knowledge, which ultimately transport them and settle down in India and live the ascetic life. No doubt they played the pivotal role in bringing together art and culture of India and Hungary. They were attracted by the landscape, the waterways, forest, gardens, village, colorful people of India, its women, children, its study, men of the soil, and its leaders. Few Indians have had the opportunity to be as close as Mahatma Gandhi, Rabindranath Tagore, Jayaprakash Narayan, Nandalal Bose, Satyajit Ray, Sarojini Nayudu, Vinoda Bhave as Elizabeth Booner. Mahatma Gandhi once teacher, can you paint my soul in half an hour? Elizabeth had no doubt tried to paint the soul of India over 50 years. Bernard Shaw once satired by giving them a piece of advice, if you want to be a famous overnight, produce a first-class book on Shakespeare, and again, if you wish to be make money, abuse India. After studying at Hungarian Academy of Fine Arts, Sas Bunner went to Simon Hollis's School of Arts. He preached them art should belong to the people and should be spread among them. He started a movement to take art to the provinces where it could be revitalized by the people's appreciation. Simon Hollis was considered as one of the greatest Hungarian resurgence of 19th century naturalism and realism schools of modern painting. The works of Bruners were inspired by both the schools. They were series of distinguished Hungarians who inspired them with India at one level or another. A scholarly, spiritual, artistic, political, such as Jacob Cronson, Alexander Kosama de Koros, great tibetologist, Gottlieb Lindner, Aurel Estin, Amita Sergil. Indian culture became very popular. मैं एक मिनट के लिए इसमें समय चाहूंगा. कल ही मैंने एक समाचार देखा अपने अखबार न्यूज़पेपर पे कि एक सज्जन जो रिलीजियस ये हैं, टूरिस्ट हैं, वो बिहार में फंस गए लॉकडाउन की वजह से. उनकी इच्छा थी कि जो जैसे दोनों माँ हंगेरियन एलिजाबेथ बुनर, उनकी माँ की इच्छा थी कि वो अलेक्जेंडर कोसामा डी कोरोस का जो है ये देखें, उनकी जो उनका जहाँ ये हुआ है, मतलब जहाँ उनका मेमोरियल है दार्जिलिंग में, उसको देखें. इनकी भी इच्छा हुई थी और ये जानने के लिए वो कई देशों से यात्रा करके दार्जिलिंग पहुंचना चाहते थे, लेकिन बीच में लॉकडाउन की वजह से सब तो फंस गया. इंडियन कल्चर बिकम वेरी पॉपुलर इन हंगरी इन द फर्स्ट डिकेड्स ऑफ 20th सेंचुरी. दिस वाज पार्टली ड्यू टू द हंगरियन कल्ट ऑफ गुरुदेव. Almost 20 of his books were translated, and he visited Hungary in 1926 and planted a sapling near Lake Balaton. Lake Balaton ka bada mahatva hai dono maa betiyon ke, Elizabeth Sas Bunner aur unki betiyon ke beech mein. Unki aneka ek painting hamare culture archive mein hai, alag alag texture mein, alag alag unke alag alag sequence mein unhone banaya hai. There were series of scholars who gave lecture to the literary genius of Gurudev in India and abroad. Dr. Sukumar Ray, the father of Satyajit Ray, also delivered some lectures on Gurudev's songs while studying photography at Royal Academy of Photographs in London. Sas Bunner liked landscape and symbolic construction, whereas Elizabeth Bunner preferred to express her experiences of life and of the universe through portraits. Dreaming of Gurudev, Rabindranath Tagore. Elizabeth Bunner once recalled her dream about the appearance of Gurudev Tagore on 19th birthday, early in the morning. ये painting जो है उसी painting, ये उसका result है, ये उसका प्रतिबिंब है ये painting, जिसको मैं ये बहुत महत्वपूर्ण painting है उन दोनों माँ बेटियों के जीवन काल के लिए. और ये painting उन्होंने 20 साल के बाद बनाया. ये उन्होंने 1930 में सपना देखा था गुरुदेव का, लेकिन 1951 में ये painting Elizabeth Bunner ने बनाया. Elizabeth Bunner कहती हैं, I dreamed that I was coming down to the cellars of the home of my birth, Nagaja Kanija, and seated in the deep dark corner, a grand old man, white bearded, holding a lamp and offering a a grand old man, white bearded, holding a lamp and offering it to my father, who was standing to his left. As my father stretched his hand to accept the lamp, the light was becoming dimmer. Seeing this, I ran to reach out to it, and glow of light came back. Now the old man looking at me and said, take this light. This light must reach every nook and corner of the world. Elizabeth Bunner recalls that when she woke up and related the dream to her mother, she exclaimed, you have seen Tagore. She explained the dream as a call to India.
without a word, she walked to the writing table and sat down, writing a letter to Tagore, describing her desire to go to India. A few photographs of her painting were attached to the letter, including a picture of the famous painting, Son of Law. She insisted that the letter had to be posted immediately. So the letter was sent before 1:30 p.m. the same day. The letter was addressed to Rabindranath Tagore, India. And it reached to Rabindranath Tagore. And the letter was, jab letter patr unke paas pahuncha, to Hungarian mein tha, nobody was able to read it. But there was a professor, Hungary professor, and Ratindranath, the son of Tagore, patr laya, unko dikhaya, unho translate kiya uska. और ट्रांसलेट करके गुरुदेव को बताया कि ये पत्र है जो एक कलाकार है, दो कलाकार माँ बेटी है, वो भारत आना चाहती है। फिर टैगोर ने उस पत्र को लिखा अंग्रेजी में, फिर उसका अनुवाद हुआ हंगरी में और वापस भेजा गया। और इसको निमंत्रण समझ के दोनों माँ बेटियां वो भारत आने की सोचने लगी। Finally, they arrived in India on February 17, 1930. Through a ship, the British officers looked at them with great suspicion, since they were wearing clothes similar to those popularized by Mahatma Gandhi's movement. Unko bada bhay laga ki ye kahin andolankari to nahi hai, ya Mahatma Gandhi ji ko ja ke unke andolan mein sharik to nahi hona chahti hain.
Sanjay, you have 5 minutes to finish the presentation.
Acha sir, acha, theek hai sir. तो अच्छा ये जो फोटो है इसके बारे में ये बताना चाहूंगा कि जब वो पहुंची वहां शांति निकेतन में और काफी देर व्यतीत करने के बाद वो गुरुदेव के हर मूड को वो कैप्चर करना चाहती थी, चाहे गुरुदेव पेंटिंग पेंटिंग कर रहे हैं, चाहे राइटिंग कर रहे हैं, चाहे इवन सो रहे हैं तो भी उसको वो पेंटिंग करना चाहती थी। एक बार वो जोनास्को में एक कमरे से दूसरे कमरे में जा रही थी तो एक फोटोग्राफ उन्होंने देखा, तो उन्होंने नंदनाथ बोस से पूछा ये किसकी फोटोग्राफ है, तो इन्होंने कहा कि ये द्वारकानाथ, महर्षि द्वारकानाथ टैगोर की फोटो है। वो बिल्कुल अवाक रह गई क्योंकि यही फोटो उन्होंने अपने सपने में देखा था और ये हिम्मत जुटा नहीं पाई उन्होंने तात्काल इस पेंटिंग को बनाने के लिए, और 20 साल लगे उनको इस पेंटिंग को साकार करने के लिए। मैं गुरुदेव रविन्द्रनाथ टैगोर के बारे में दो शब्द बोलना चाहूंगा कि एस राधाकृष्णन ने अपने बुक लिविंग विद अ पर्पस में कहा है कि रविन्द्रनाथ टैगोर रेज द स्टेचर ऑफ आवर कंट्री इन द आईज ऑफ द वर्ल्ड। ही वाज अ वर्सटाइल जीनियस, ए लिटरेरी आर्टिस्ट, एन एजुकेटर, ए कंपोजर, ए सिंगर, एन एक्टर। A commonwealth of mind and spirit is a prelude to a political commonwealth. Tagore was a world citizen, a Vishwamanav. He was not only a poet, a playwright, but a novelist and a storyteller, a composer, an actor, a serious thinker, a social reformer, an educator, a nationalist, and internationalist. As if these activities are not enough, he turned to painting towards the end of his life. Tagore's nationalism is internationalism. In a poem called Pravasi, the immigrant, he writes, "My home is everywhere. I am in search of it. My country is in all countries. I will struggle to attain it." Elizabeth Sarsbrunner had a passion for gardening and she obtained some seeds of flowers from Hungary and planted them, experimenting to find out how they would grow in India. These plants did fairly well in new soil. She presented Gurudev with the first Hungarian paprika grown by her in India. She tried her new methods of cultivation and she found gardening a stimulating ways of meditation. Ruti Babu offered a piece of land for the same. जहाँ तक हम जानते हैं गुरुदेव अपने जन्मदिन में एक पेड़ लगाते थे और रोज ही वो अपने बगीचे में जो आवश्यक रूप से ट्रैवल करते थे जाते थे। He used to take a solitary walk in the morning, often among the trees that he had planted each year on the occasion of his birthday. Tagore was an environmental pioneer. Tagore first became the concerned about
man's impact on the environment after seeing an oil spill at sea on his way to Japan in 1960. Decades before an environmental movement emerged in the West, the experience provoked Tagore to write at length about his annoyance at the way modern man was failing to respect nature. However, Tagore didn't simply look for a solution to the problem. He made something creative creative out of his environmental campaign. In 1970, he started an annual tree planting ceremony in Shantiniketan, that is Vrikhoropan, at which the student would sing, read his poem. This approach gave his environmental campaign a very positive image, so that negative campaign, but what man should not do. Rather, it was a subtle reminder conveyed through creative expression. This encouraged more people to get involved in supporting his campaign. This ceremony is still held each year in Shantiniketan. Classes in Shantiniketan were in the shades of the tree, not simply as a romantic idea, but as a deliberate way of bringing a student closer to nature so that they would unconsciously learn to respect it. He also started a new celebration of the arrival of the monsoon at the end of the dry season, Borso Mangal. एक चीज में कुछ हमारी पेंटिंग है संथाल
संजय यू हैव टू फिनिश बिकॉज़ अदर वी हैव थ्री मोर स्पीकर्स सो वी कैन नॉट लाइक यू हैव ऑलरेडी टेकन 20 मिनट्स
सर आई विल टेक 2 मिनट्स इट्स अबाउट द अवनींद्रनाथ टैगोर अवनींद्रनाथ टैगोर जो है डॉक्टर अवनींद्रनाथ टैगोर भारतीय चित्रकला के पुनरुद्धारक रूप में प्रतिष्ठित हुए हैं वे नोबेल पुरस्कार विजेता गुरुदेव रविन्द्रनाथ टैगोर के भतीजे थे उन्होंने अपना चित्रकार जीवन अंग्रेजी वातावरण की धूमधाम से पोर्ट्रेट बनाने से प्रारंभ किया उनके इस आरंभिक कृतित्व पे यूरोपियन पद्धति के धनी चित्रकार जतुनाथ जो उनके परिवार के ही थे उनके संपर्क का बहुत असर पड़ता है एक लाइन जो मैं पढ़ना चाहता हूँ इनके बारे में बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण है जब गुरुदेव जापान जाते हैं तो उन्होंने अवनी बाबू को पत्र लिखा अवन मैं जापान में जितनी अधिक यात्रा करता हूँ मुझे उतना ही अधिक यह अनुभव होता है कि तुम्हें वहां होना चाहिए था हर समय अपने दक्षिण के बरामदे में देखिए बड़ा इंपॉर्टेंट है दक्षिण के बरामदे में पलथी मार कर बैठे बैठे तुम कभी भी यह अनुभव नहीं कर पाओगे कि जापान की जीवंत कला में से संपर्क करना कितना अधिक महत्वपूर्ण ताकि स्वयं हमारी कला पुनर्जीवित हो सके और फल फूल सके जो शांतिनिकेतन की स्थापना हुई थी अबोड ऑफ पीस और उसमें जो आसपास जो गांव है जिसमें संथाली लोग आदिवासी लोग बसते हैं उनकी जीवन कला उनकी जीवंत कला उनकी जो कला ग्राम संस्कृति वो बहुत अधिक प्रभावित करती है शांतिनिकेतन के पूरे कला प्रदर्शन को मैं इसी के साथ अपना खत्म करता हूँ धन्यवाद प्रणाम
Thank you, Sanjay. Now you can
Sorry,
stop.
माफी चाहता हूँ दीक्षा.
नहीं नहीं कोई problem. You can stop share now. And so thank you very much. Now moving ahead with the program, the next speaker in the list is my colleague, Dr. Brijendra Bangaru. Dr. Brijendra Bangaru is going to speak on Venets of Bengal by foreign travelers, 19th-20th century from rare book collection of IGNC. बेसिकली आई जस्ट वॉन्ट टू ब्रिंग योर अटेंशन कि ये एग्जीबिशन हम लोग 24 अप्रैल को एक दूसरी एग्जीबिशन थी इसी का एक पार्ट था उसको हमने एक वर्चुअल एग्जीबिशन के फॉर्म में ऑलरेडी 24 अप्रैल को लॉन्च किया हुआ है वो ऑलरेडी यूट्यूब पर अवेलेबल है तो जो डॉक्टर बांगरू आपको इसी एग्जीबिशन का एक पार्ट था उसको उसके बारे में क्योंकि एग्जीबिशन काफी बड़ी थी उसमें 3 डॉक्यूमेंट्री थी और बाकी ऑब्जेक्ट्स थे तो जो डॉक्यूमेंट्री थी उसमें से एक डॉक्यूमेंट्री को हमने जो 24 अप्रैल को लॉन्च किया गुरुदेव रविन्द्रनाथ टैगोर के ऑनर में उसी के बारे में वीरेंद्र बांगरू जी आपको ये जो उनका टॉपिक है बताएंगे तो मैं बांगरू जी आपको इनवाइट करता हूँ कि
प्लीज थैंक यू सर Sir, is my voice audible?
Yeah,
sir?
Yeah, very much audible. Yeah, please go ahead.
Thanks, sir. Thanks a lot. Respected Professor Sajidanand Joshi ji, Member Secretary IGNC, Professor Ramesh Goad, HOD Kalanidhi and Dean IGNC, Dr. Achal Pandya, Professor Sanjay Malik, Dr. Kumar Sanjay Jha, online scholars and friends. The land of Bengal has acted as a creative canvas and inspired artists, writers, and philosophers. European colonial forces established it as a trade center and Calcutta its epicenter. Soon it started attracting foreign nationals from all walks of life, mostly traders and some military explorers. Some, during the course of their stay, were fascinated by the rich cultural heritage of the region and started photo-documenting it and writing about it. From snake charmers to lost world civilization, all sort of Indic publications found a good market in the West. The photographic reproductions displayed in one of the galleries at Belvedere House, Kolkata, organized by IGNCA, represented paintings and drawings by foreign travelers visiting Bengal in 18th, 19th century. These photographic reproductions were taken from the visual archives of IGNCA. In the slide unit of Kalanidhi, IGNCA, there are more than 1 lakh visuals of Indian art, architecture, and performing arts. All the visuals are catalogued and metadata computerized for easy access. In the visual collection of IGNCA, there are many visuals on Bengal art, architecture, culture, performing arts. Kaligat painting and Pattachitra of Bengal finds place in leading museums of Europe and America. We have a good collection of these copies acquired from Victor Albert Museum, London. Terracotta temples of Bengal, festivals, traditional dances, and colonial architecture has also been documented by IGNCA and features in the visual collection of Kalanidhi. One of the interesting collections are the visuals documented from the illustrated rare books in IGNCA. Rare books are shelved separately because of rarity of the subject, out-of-date publication, and also of the fragile nature. The illuminations and drawings published in these rare books, rare volumes, throw ample light on the art, architecture, and culture of the bygone era. Some of the rare books are illustrated with sketches, drawings, lithographs, etchings, woodcuts, and in some of the rare publications, there are the original photographs, which add an extra dimension for studying the various aspects of Indian art and culture. Some of the rare illustrated manuscripts from IGNCA are History of Hindustan by Thomas Morris, published in 1795, Views of East by Captain Robert Elliot, published in 1833, Recollections of India by Charles Stewart Harding, published in 1847, Sketches in Dakhin by Captain Phillips Meadows, published in 1837. Then there is Oriental Annual Series by Herbert Compton, published in 1836 with beautiful sketches and drawings. Letters Written in Maratha Camp by Thomas Dewar Brookington, published in 1813. This publication also has colored drawings of festivals and festivities. La Hindus by Francois Balthazar Solvin, published in 1811. And then The Views of Calcutta by James Fraser, published in 1826. More than 100 illustrated rare books were selected from IGNCA collection, and visuals in these books listed and photo-documented by IGNCA in-house team. The wide variety of visuals, drawings, sketches, woodcuts, etchings, lithographs, paintings, photographs, when enlarged, revealed a lot more, thus opening a new insight for better appreciating the art and the artist, and also the captured scenes. Looking at the wide range of subjects covered and the quality of photo documentation, it was decided to curate an exhibition. For curating the exhibition, Images of India, a fascinating journey through time, the 18th, 19th century visuals were selected to give glimpses of old landscape of the important cities, architecture of temples, mosques, tombs, and living quarters, social life during the period, and details of musical instruments, costumes. And we have also the transportation and other objects of interest. The first exhibition based on illustrated books titled Glimpses of Pristine India was organized in IGNCA in February 2008. The exhibition titled Vignettes of Kashmir's Life and Culture was also curated from the rare book illustrations and held on 29th Feb 2008 in IGNCA. Another exhibition, again from the Illustrated Rare Books, titled Images of India, was also organized in Delhi in Feb 2010. The exhibition based on Illustrated Rare Books was very much appreciated and taken to different destinations across India. So we have Images of India held at Indira Gandhi Stadium, which was done in collaboration with Ministry of External Affairs, and it was held in October 2015. Then again, when it traveled to Punjab University, Patiala, and there it was exhibited in April 2016. Again, it was organized at Shaheed Bhagat Singh College, Delhi, in March 2017. And then from there, it traveled to Rampur, and from Rampur to Aligarh, different destinations across India. So for the present lecture, I'll be focusing on the life and works of Franco S. Balthazar Solvin and James Valley Fraser, who contributed immensely portraying Bengal. IGNCA is in possession of some of the rare volumes of both the authors. Franco Balthazar Solvin was born in July 1760 in Belgium and pursued his studies in art from Paris. From there, he moved to Brussels, Australia, and worked as a painter and graphic artist. Looking for some big fortune in colonial India, he arrived in Calcutta in 1791, but he had to struggle for getting the job and eventually settled for taking up the work of decorating palanquins, carriages, or bridge. At the same time, he continued doing series of etchings depicting everyday life of Bengal. He published his first collection of around about 250 etchings under the title, A Collection of 250 Colored Etchings, Descriptive of the Manners, Customs, and Dresses of the Hindus in Calcutta in 1796. His works covered the castes and their professions, costumes, means of transport, musical instruments, and festivals. In the transport, he painted different types of carriages, palanquins, and ships of different types. Sir, are you listening to me, sir? Is it audible? Hello?
Yes, very much audible. You continue.
Thank you, sir. His first venture in the publication wasn't received well, this venture of Balthazar Solvin. Some attribute his failure due to his presentation of drawings, which were very monotonous and dull. After his unsuccessful tenure in India and venture in publication, he returned to Europe in 1803 after staying 11 years in Kolkata. In France, he reworked his etchings with redesigned prints in warm colors, along with the bilingual French-English edition in 4 volumes. He was helped by his wife, she was English knowing, and they brought out the 4 volumes titled Less Hindus. These volumes were published from 1808 to 1812, sir. 4 volumes comprised 48 parts with a total of 288 color printed plates. IGNCA is in possession of all the 4 volumes of this prestigious publication. The original drawings were drawn in Bengal and represent variety of professions, castes and class, true to life portrait he has drawn in his compositions. His works are very important for ethnographic studies, showcasing people and customs of Bengal. Then, sir, another celebrated artist, James Valley Fraser. He was an artist, writer, and traveler. He was born in 1783 in Scotland and grew up at Edinburgh. From 1799 to 1811, he went to Guyana to see his sugar plantation estate. In 1813, he sailed for India, hoping for a trade business in Calcutta. He was not successful in trade venture and eventually settled for doing jobs at various places in India. In 1816, he returned to Calcutta and joined shipping business. It was in Calcutta he took interest in art and worked with William Havell and George Chinnery. In 1826, he published Views of Calcutta and its environs. Where IGNCA is in possession of this prestigious publication, The Views of Calcutta, The colored plates in this publication are picturesque and represent various colonial buildings in Calcutta. James Bellew Fraser has many other publications to his credit, like Snowy Range of Himalayan Mountains, Source of River Jumna and Ganga, which was published in 1820. Then there is another publication, Journey into Khorasan, Persia, 1825. Tale of Khorasan, it is published in 1828. Then there is Highland Smugglers. It was published in 1832. These are all the publications of James Fraser. Sir, in conclusion, I would like to say that the modern Indian art movement in India is considered to have begun in Calcutta, which was as a result of Western influence. In the beginning of 18th century, we saw many European artists, such as Zofing, Kettle, Hodges, Thomas and William Daniels, Reynolds, Emily Eden, and George Chinnery, who came to India and painted scenes of everyday life, regalia of princely courts, and native festivities and rituals, which also saw emergence of company style and Bengal civil art. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Bangru, for your wonderful narration. Dr. Bangru has extensively worked on our various rare book collections, and as he mentioned in his address that several exhibitions have been organized based on these collections. And as I introduced you in the beginning, that this one of the virtual exhibition is already on IGNC YouTube channel. Even these recordings will also be available on IGNC YouTube channel. So whenever you want to see IGNC and this virtual exhibition, which we are going to showcase today, will also be there on IGNC YouTube channel. So you subscribe IGNC YouTube channel and have plenty of material. IGNC's Facebook Live series and other webinars and other programs, everything is being uploaded. There are several videos of our member secretary on different aspects of Indian art and cultural heritage, including manuscript heritage, are available on that. So there's a lot of information. So wonderful presentation, Bangruji, and I'm grateful to you for your hard work and commitment for this kind of, I think before moving to my next speaker, Achal, let me just give you some glimpses of this exhibition, what we did in Calcutta. There is a 7-8 minute video. We'll just show you that how it was displayed and what are the different kind of object displayed. So just 6 to 7 minute this video will be played, and you will enjoy this. I'm opening a wrong video. Just give me 1 minute. Just give me 1 minute.
सर फिल्म नहीं आ रही है
जस्ट अ मिनट आई विल जस्ट कैन यू सी इट नाउ
Yes, sir.
ये तो संजय जी का प्रेजेंटेशन दोबारा लग गया गौर साहब
सर वही उसमें थोड़ा सा उसमें कुछ गैप्स थे उनको जरा फास्ट करने के लिए These were Dr. Bangaru's presentation, what Dr. Bangaru was talking about. These were the objects.
These are the reproductions of
reproductions.
Manuscripts, illustrated air books. This is again by the Balthazar Solon, this paintings.
So these were some of the glimpses of the virtual exhibition which we are going to upload on the YouTube. This is just an introduction to that particular virtual exhibition which will be uploaded, because that size is coffee very high and we cannot play it here. So now I would like to invite my colleague, Dr. Achal Pandya, who is the head of conservation division in IGNCA. He will be speaking on conservation of oil paintings with special reference to Brunner's collection. So over to Achal. Please just start your presentation. Achal, please unmute yourself. Achal, please start. Yeah, your slides are visible. You can do the slides show.
Namaskar, Member Secretary sir, Dean sir, Dr. Sanjoy Malik sir, all the panelists, my colleagues, and all the audience who are attending this seminar. A very, very good afternoon to all of you. Very warm good afternoon to all of you. I'll be speaking, in fact, on the conservation of oil paintings with special reference to Brunner's paintings, which are from the collection of cultural archives of the IGNCA. In fact, Dr. Sanjay Jha has already spoken in detail about the paintings of Brunner, in fact, who had come from Hungary along with her mother Elizabeth Sass Brunner and settled down in India. So, in fact, the problems that we faced in Brunner's oil painting is that she had painted on any surface which was readily available to her. She had not gone into the durability of the material which she used as a support. And for example, if you paint oil paints on cardboards, it's really, really, very difficult in long term for the conservation of the objects. So she used cardboards. You see the front and the rear image, rear of the painting. Then she also used canvas, but you can see the stretcher that has been used in this canvas is also not of a very, very good quality, and that leads to its deterioration. This is again an oil on canvas. And the problems that we saw on Bruner's paintings were dust and dirt, the stain splash, bulging, sagging of the canvas, tears. There was also loss of support, and the loss of support means that cardboard is completely broken or mezzanine board is completely lost. Loss of paint, cracks and creases. You can see this type of problems that you see, bulging, and you see creases on the painting, the cracks, the drying of paint, loss of paint in this case, a very beautiful painting, but you can easily see the paint has been lost at the surfaces. And then this was a painting on a mezzanite board, which you can see a loss of the mezzanite board itself, a big loss. Here also you see the loss of the mezzanite board. Here also you see the loss of the mezzanite board. And when I talk of the same painting, you can see that while for hanging this painting, they had done the holes in the mezzanite board, so that they are able to screw it on the wall. That has again become the cause of damage. And you can see these paint things. Because painting is very large, wherever it was displayed, so painting was not removed while doing the painting in that place. That's how the splashes of paint have come. And you can also see abrasions and all. Another thing about Bruner's painting is that she at many times she was not using the removal of the paint layer from the painting. So this is a painting which is during cleaning. So this is how the before and after of the painting, you can see the effects that comes up when you do a basic cleaning of a painting. One thing I would like to tell you is that whatever treatment we do in IGNC conservation laboratory, it is really minimum intervention. We do not at all intervene with the artist's intention. So whatever work we have done is really minimum. That does not mean that it's very less work. It means it's an extensive work. Whenever you are doing a minimum work, you have to put extensive efforts. You have to really document the painting, and you have to find out what was the artist's intent and what was the real root cause of the problem. So in doing that, once you have done all these things, then it is easy to implement your strategy, and that is we call it as minimum intervention. So whatever we have done in this painting is reversible. We have not added any extra things in it. We have not done any painting over the painted surface which was done originally by Bruner. So this is whenever we do conservation of any oil painting, it is very, very important that a detailed documentation is done, cleaning, consolidation in case paint layer is weak, and we have to settle the paint on the painting, tear banding, in case there is a tear in card, for example, we saw a cardboard. There are paper paintings also which were done by Bruner's. There's a tear, then tear is mended. Strip lining is done. In fact, in IGNCA, we normally in 99% of the cases, we try not to give a lining to a painting, because lining adds more weight to the painting, and also whenever we line a painting with an adhesive, the original painting, there is an foreign material which is introduced and which remains in large quantity and it remains with the painting forever, and whenever in case this foreign material it penetrates the painting, then it can also cause discoloration of the surface or changes in the surface which are against the artist's intention. So normally we try to do all the mending, localized mending, strip lining. Strip lining is done normally because when a painting is stretched, people they use nails to do it, and over a period of time when nails they get rusted, there is a big hole on that areas wherever nails were fixed. That's why you have to do a strip lining of that so that you are again able to re-stretch the painting. So lining is only if it is required, only in extreme cases where the old canvas has completely become very frail and is unable to hold the painting. Filling and texturing, retouching and varnishing in case painting is varnished. In case, so this conservation plan, deterioration, treatment, I've already spoken about it. In this painting, it was varnished also. You can see a mark change comes up when a painting is done, is cleaned in a really systematic manner. So when again I come back to the collection of Gunnar, which is very important as it includes the journey of an artist from Hungary to India. A study of different Indian elements and its depiction on canvas and board is marvelous. The support used by artist is not of the best quality. He used whatever was readily available, cardboard, bentonite board, etc. And they are problematic supports due to their degrading properties. The cardboard is inherently acidic. Bentonite board is also inherently acidic. So conservation of these paintings is in process. We are doing the detailed documentation of the painting, stabilization, and eventually remedial conservation and restoration, so that whenever a painting is chosen for an exhibition, we do some amount of restoration also, so that the visitor is able to understand the intent of the artist and how it was made. Thank you for your attention. And in case of any questions related to conservation laboratory of the IGNCA, I am always at your disposal. You can always reach me on the email which Orsa will share with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Achal, for a brief and very beautiful presentation. And I'm sure curating an exhibition involved number of steps, and taking care of conservation needs is one of the very important, both in terms of restoration as well as exhibiting any object which is of very historical nature. And with the help of you, Cultural Archive of IGNC has hosted several exhibitions, and you are always, it may be early paintings or collection from various other collection on puppets and all those things. You are always very supportive. So thank you very much for your continued support and active role in showcasing cultural heritage resources from Kalanidhi. Jo hamara bhandar hai, usko aap kaise logon tak pahunchaye, usme aapka bahut bada ahem role hai. And I'm always grateful to you for that role. Now everybody is waiting to listen. None other than Professor Sanjay Malik, a well-known person from History of Arts, currently Principal Kala Bhavan of Vishwa Bharati in Shanti Niketan. And he'll be speaking on Rabindranath Tagore, comprehending his relevance as a painter in the context of early Indian modern art. So over to Dr. Malik for your presentation.
Thank you. I begin with a sincere note of thanks to the chair and the moderator for this opportunity to present at the webinar. And I also have a word of apology to all because of my inability to speak in Hindi. I am not a Tagore scholar with empirical research on him. There are infinitely more qualified scholars who should have been here in my position. However, I'm an ardent admirer of the immense towering personality and his indefatigable capacity for creative expression. This is not an apology, but a clarification. What will follow thereafter, collected and put together from scholars with original research on Rabindranath, is more like a curated exhibition. Every selection also implies certain exclusions, and I would prefer that you look on the same as essentially a personal choice. I take the liberty here of emblematically putting on screen the words that are Vishwabharati's motto, Yatra Vishwa Bhavati Eka Niram. The world in a nest is not merely the guiding light for this institute, but I believe a conviction that characterizes him. Much before he had actually begun painting, in a letter to his daughter, Rabindranath Tagore wrote that he laments that painting wasn't really his forte. Had it been so, he would have demonstrated what needed to be done. Even earlier, in a letter addressed to the scientist Jagadish Chandra Bose, Rabindranath had mentioned in an ebullient tone that it would surprise the latter to learn that he had been painting in a sketchbook, although the effort with the pencil was being overtaken by the effort with the eraser, such that Raphael could lie peacefully in his grave without the fear of being rivaled. He certainly was aware of the muse of the visual arts and of the artists whom he considered ideals. It is known to all that Rabindranath ventured into the domain of painting quite late. By then, he was well acclaimed as a poet. The manuscript of his book of poems, Puravi, is conventionally identified as the first evidence of his articulation through full-fledged visual images, significantly independent of the text. Therefore, they are not illustrations. From these beginnings to the series of exhibitions that he held abroad and beyond, we find an individual sincerely articulating himself through the visual mode, producing an oeuvre of about 2,500 pictorial statements within the span of 15 years. The clarity of distinction between fact and image is evident in his autobiographical recollection, The Jeevan Sriti, and it is what you can see on screen where he says that whoever is painting pictures on memory's canvas is painting. He is painting pictures and not writing history. And these are the quotes that Dr. Sanjay had also referred to, that he'd been writing back to his nephews saying that you should leave this is the sanctity of your south veranda and go abroad and see what's happening all around. As we look through select examples from Rabindranath Tagore's oeuvre of paintings, let us remember that one could probably identify four major coordinates along which to consider the visual practice. And these are what you see on screen, that he had a global vision of culture rather than the squinted nationalism. He had an approach to the visual from one of the purest of elements of creative urge with his rhythm. And then progressing from automatic scribbles and subconscious images, he went on to more consciously formed images, where obviously there was the expressionistic character and also probably a certain subconscious, which some prefer to call the surreal. And then he had a very, very open approach to global primitive art as source for visual imagery that is very important for a contemporary painter. So begin with automatism and rhythm. The manuscript is a private domain of the poet. As he proceeded to edit and alter the text, joined together the struck out words formed a kind of a rhythmic pattern of linear scribbles. The connected erasers emerged into consolidated, united, and independent identity of fantastic visual forms. On this, he had once written that I had come to know that rhythm gives reality to that which is desultory, which is insignificant in itself. And he said that they often took more time in rescuing them into merciful finality of rhythm rather than carrying on what was my obvious task. And obviously the obvious task was continuing to write poetry, but instead he used to be found scribbling images onto the sheet paper. Puravi translations fused into the unity of design through automatism and rhythm, and a host of unique forms, most often curious and grotesque, emerged in the process, apparently from the subconscious, unpremeditated, and it was this unpredictable that delighted him. These were creatures that defied classification according to strict conventions of zoology, but possessed distinctly identifiable moods, emotions, and characteristics. They became personalities rather than blank forms. From the private and the personal domain of the manuscript, the poet painter turned to full scale paintings. However, having originated from the subconscious playfulness of his erasers, Ravindra's pictorial practice unfortunately tended to carry the stigma of being a dilettante's dabble that received adulation only because of his stature as a renowned literary personality. It is true that he did not possess an academic initiation into the visual arts, but in the Jivan Sriti, he has recorded that in his childhood memory, when at sleep time, he would stare at the patterns of peeling whitewash on the walls, which would induce a range of visual forms in his imagination as he drifted off to sleep. Very evidently, Rabindranath did possess the elemental faculty of visual imagination. By 1930, however, Rabindranath was relatively confident of his efforts as a painter. In a letter dated 26th April addressed to Indira Devi, his niece, he mentions that the inauguration of the exhibition was scheduled for the 2nd of May. But he also wrote that the harvest at the year end has been collected together on these foreign shores and that he would prefer to leave them behind, considering it fortunate that he has been able to cross over from the ferry wharf of his own land. Rabindranath's acclaim from the series of foreign exhibitions has been a long-standing suspicion of indulgent praise. What counters these doubts is the consistency of his pictorial quest and the enormous output. Scholars claim that he had brought along with him as many as 400 paintings for the 1930 exhibitions. What is of interest beyond the numbers are the choices exercised by Rabindranath as a painter. In a period when nationalist revivalism was triumphant in that country, he had the strength of will to propose a larger vision beyond the restrictive criteria of nationalist geographical boundaries in matters of creative expression. This is where Yatra Vishwa Bhavati Ek Niram becomes a very significant code word to follow, where the whole world comes to meet as in a single nest, represents the Catholicity that distinguished this creative process, his liberated notion of tradition. And he had traveled abroad quite extensively. His European tours had probably contributed quite a lot to his understanding of the art of these lands. And here are a few examples of what is usually cited as the sources that contributed to the scribbles and the forms: British Columbia, Easter Island. And one would also find that even if one identifies connections and echoes, the images in Rabindranath Tagore remain so, so individual that they defy categorization into straitjackets of stylistic periodization or movements in world art. Now, Rabindranath was a poet, and as a poet, one would be thinking about illuminations of his own texts. And he did do illuminations for his own texts, not appointing artists to do them, but he did his own in certain cases. And one of them happens to be this book called Shay. Shay is a prose written in sometime around 1936-37 AD. And it's a delightful and charming dialogue between generations, between a Pupe Didi and her grandfather, who collaboratively invent a narrative along the flights of fancy and reason. What you see on screen is a picture dozen pages down the beginning, a drawing that attempts to depict that part of the narrative corresponding to the story that says that a jackal called Pouho had to be christened into a more humanly decent name of Shivuram. Initially, the first step in making a man out of a jackal obviously was to effort to train him into sitting or standing upright. And this is what you find in the left-hand side picture, that there is a certain set of flowing arabesques. Not so much a biological correspondence to a jackal, but the deftly fluid character of the contour defines a merrily optimistic tone about the transformation from a jackal to a human being. As the narrative followed, you see the second picture on the right, and this is about Shivuram, who was being told that he still wasn't quite human enough because he possessed a tail. Would he be able to relinquish a tail and become human? So in this picture, having relinquished the tail, what we know is that he went howling the night away, lamenting, where's my tail gone, oh, where's my tail? And in the corresponding picture, Rabindranath alters his linear character. From the flowing arabesque, he makes it pointed, he makes it very sharp, he makes it angular, and that all combines together to become a poignant expression of lament. The utter seriousness of an artist striving through the elements of pictorial language towards a valid pictorial form would also be apparent in these two pictures. And they are once again a pair that distinguish between something called the bell-eared, which is on the left-hand side, the Ghanta Corno, and the bell-eared of the fierce kind, which is on the right-hand side, once again, the lyrical being replaced by the angular. Having begun the journey from manuscript cancellations, Rabindranath evidently was most comfortable in this zone where lack of academic training did not stand in the way of visual expression and the desired visual expression. If required, he could certainly produce fairly accurate and convincing correspondences to a tiger. And very interestingly, the text tells us that the tiger was one who smiles, and this is within quotes, smiles as soon as the window is open. I don't know which tiger would smile at if you open a window, but that's the alternating fancy and realism that goes on in the text. He's also very able to draw a kind of a rabbit in the orb of the moon, something that we commonly have been told by our grandmothers when we were children. But what you see on the right-hand lower corner of your screen is an illustration, which is number 67 poem of a book called Kapchara of the same era, 1936-37. And in the 67 poem, the poetry is very small. It just goes on an eight-liner, which says that there was a kind of a toad which became a ghost and came on and placed the cold foot on the shoulder of Bono Mali uncle, and Bono Mali uncle plead that he be spared the cold touch, to which this toad merely said a croak. And what we find in the image is that the image accompanying the eight-liner is an extremely simple, almost organic, almost amoebic form that is in nowhere an absolute literal correspondence. And yet it is in this perfect embodiment of the ghost toad's chuckle at Bono Mali uncle's distraught condition. Obviously, Bono Mali is nowhere in the picture. From these then onwards to actual animals and bird forms that he painted, pure fancy as an impetus collaborated with an acute clarity regarding the possibilities of visual language. So you find a bird rides a beast, the simple contour line and the shape of the resultant mass, translating them into personalities with anthropomorphic expressions of one being in control of the other. Very similarly, a part human, part bird configuration continues to bear the imprint of the free-flowing characteristic of his manuscript illustrations. Now more confident as a purely imaginary skeletal structure, a maze of thick and thin interspaces between the lines and the scribbled tonal textures of washes of ink, and the face obviously appears to smile. As forms engage in dialogue, the more human their gestures appear to be, and the more they represent figures that are distinct personalities rather than pure form alone. An unexpected back view, a neck bent low, amply translates into the statement about character, the swing of the unmistakably thick tail ringing with the same tune. But it is in the monumental example of a bird in flight that Rabindranath excelled above the rest. And evidence of his pictorial achievement is coated with the subtly graded tones of ink. These clearly mark out the skeletal understructure of the head and the beak, the compositional placement of a brilliantly illuminated form against the dark depths of the background gives us a sweeping curve of the wing body to the beak, implying an albatross-like silent giant flight over our heads. Lack of orthodox training is nowhere a limitation. Faces. It should be no wonder for a man from literature to turn to human figures, especially faces, in his paintings. Faces that are not illusory portraits of specific individuals, but rather character studies, perhaps types, that certainly emerge from the visual impression of people observed. They have distinctly personal presence with expressions ranging from the sullen and the somber to the calm and the content, and in rare instances to the joyful or the merry. However, whichever be the particular expression of the painted faces, they invariably exude a feeling of untold mystery, as if the whole of the personality is beyond complete comprehension. From faces, it is a step towards figures grouped in silence or engaged in mutual communication. Even when his pictures deal with the dramatic ensembles of multiple human figures, the narrative is entirely contained within the perimeter of the painted page without drawing any reference to literary allusions, whether belonging to a shared tradition or to those of his own creation. What unfolds in front of the viewer of these paintings is a narrative told exclusively through the language of the visual and meant to be read so as well. Rabindranath painted himself several times, and in some of these drawings, parallels are often drawn to German expressionist pictorial language. For example, between his self-portrait and the one by Emil Nolde called Prophet. Very close in terms of time, 1912, 1935. And should we go on, what should draw our attention more is this page. On the cover of May 1934, volume 2, number 2 issue of Vishwavarti News, as you can see, it's a birthday number, it came out with a photo portrait of Rabindranath Tagore. On a couple of these covers, he painted them, or rather overpainted them, in ink, pastel, watercolor, transforming each of these faces into distinctly differing identities. In many of these, the ink scribbles and tones spare the eye, which continue to glow, piercing out from beneath the cloak of pictorial transformation. But in a few, he even overpainted them as well. Not only does this exercise address the issue of the real as illusory appearance, it also introduces us to the issue of identity, especially when one realizes that a couple of these reworked faces definitely look distinctly feminine. For a poet who celebrated nature extensively, it is but natural that landscapes would form a major section of his oeuvre. The man-nature equation of harmonious balance in Rabindranath's world of ideas finds its pictorial equivalence in these painted vistas, often turning out to be statements of the pantheistic. Explicating what Shantiniketan meant to its responsive independence, artist Binod Bihari Mukherjee once mentioned, and I quote, "Rabindranath did manage to create an environment where one could realize that life was full of excitement and that one could deliver oneself from the darkness of self-distrust and inertia through creative activity. With each change of season, he brought us a basket of songs. The memory of the atmosphere that these songs and nature's glory contrived together is still green in every student's mind," unquote. It may be profitable to consider and to view these landscapes painted by Rabindranath along the same lines as his poetry, as baskets of songs contributing to that memory of atmosphere together with nature herself. They are hardly ever descriptive passages where it may be possible to determine the inspiring source in actual landscapes and locations. Nevertheless, for the likes of us who have been fortunate to experience Shantiniketan in all its natural glory, some of the glowing yellow skies behind the silhouette of trees in the foreground invariably seem so familiar. And yet, beyond a broadly general identification, the landscapes do remain largely non-specific, universal maybe so, and it is a sum total of all the sensory perceptions of nature put together. While the oral in his basket of songs could produce painted visible equivalents of seasonal beauty, the visible in the pictures could equally resonate to the ambient music of the seasons. We began by mentioning of his man-nature harmonious existence. We now conclude with a painting that is at the same time a landscape as well as a self-image, where the self-portrait in the center dissolves into the natural vista situated within it and holding the same within itself. Now I'll ask you to spare me a couple of minutes more while I place Rabindranath Tagore in context, because having traveled this far, I crave your indulgence for quickly flipping through these images. It was a period in history where traveling European painters had been picturing India through the linguistic mode of romantic illusion and academic realism, William Hodges being one of those examples. It was also the period when the official schools of art were being set up in the various cities in India to train the Indian in a realism very, very alien to his national pictorial proclivities. Out of this myriad dimensions of encounter emerged what is commonly called the company school, of which you see an example at the bottom. Sheikh Muhammad Amir of Karaya, very close to Bengal. Naturalism also manifested in the personality of Raja Ravi Verma, who usurped the language of realism from the colonizer, who voiced narratives from his national past into majestic statements of monumental proportions. But in a counter move to all of these, there was a tracing of the roots, and Abanindranath Tagore comes as the prime protagonist in this case, who harked back to pictorial language from the past in his own country and to painting from the Far East. These emerged into uniquely contextual modern achievements. His students and followers established the reverse trend to naturalism and gave rise to what is known as the Bengal school, which is nuanced romantic view of the world. However, Abanindranath's brother Gaganendranath was a painter of a different mold who had no qualms over adopting the cubist pictorial norms into his own. He was also the one who could explore caricatures as serious visual statements, but he was the only one who could take the liberties with Rabindranath himself in his first flight across the skies by depicting him as flying off while his books and pen fly back in a reverse direction. As a student of Abanindranath, Nandalal Bose began with the past pictorial languages, especially the mural traditions of India, but the impact of Shantiniketan as a location and Rabindranath as a leading personality weaned him out of this hothouse culture of Calcutta, and such that his Arjun could now be a local archer, not the mythological distant. It is with him that Rabindranath collaborated on a primer for children known as Sahaj Path, Easy Lessons. And it is here that the utter simplicity of the pure black and white Dinokar images complemented the simple couplets, urging the young minds who read the book to explore and to imagine rather than something. Nan Vinod Bihari unfortunately lost sight, but went on to produce some of the most remarkable visual statements, among which the mural in ceramic tile exploring the local ambience stands out in prominence. Equally, in the world of sculpture, Ramkinkar Bage began with exalting monumental depictions of the mundane life of the local tribals known as the Santal community, but it was the Catholicity of Rabindranath that gave him the ideal ambience to explore the abstract as a sculptural possibility. Even in the radical depiction of the poet himself from naturalism back to severely abstracted forms. In Shantiniketan, Rabindranath wanted his institute, Kala Bhavan, to be a true center for exploring the visual beyond the art school paradigm. This is precisely why community activity of murals painted on walls, of makeup and costume design for performers on stage, and the transformation of floor decoration from its original religious association to a more secular community activity were all seen to have the same aesthetic status as creative visual activity. The most unique statement culminating out of all of this is the unbaked clay building known as the Black House, which functioned as a hostel for students. Tar-coated clay reliefs depicting a range of images from Indus Valley to Assyria, from Egyptian art to that of Mahabalipuram, coexisted on the walls. Here was an encyclopedic compendium of art, past and present, recreated by the very people who would then eventually use the space as their own accommodation. To Rabindranath Tagore, the issues that held a place of primary consequence for the practice of the visual arts was entirely different from those that determine the general course of art and its history. Addressing factors of considerably wider implications than those that were of immediate concern to his contemporaries, Rabindranath personified a vision of much larger dimension, indexing a direction of possibility in pictorial practice that was exemplary, but was also uniquely individual. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you, Dr. Malik, for such an excellent presentation. It's mind-blowing, and thanks for showing such a hidden treasure, which I think we are blessed with your lecture to see these wonderful things. I'm sure all participants must have enjoyed the visuals and your narrative and the way you have just the way you explain each and everything. It's so wonderful to hear you. So
thank you, sir.
Please, thank you very much for such a wonderful lecture, and we are honored to have you here. And
my pleasure and honor.
Yeah. So we'll take a few questions, and then our member secretary will conclude. There is a question by Dr. Neha from Delhi University. What are the contributions of Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore in nation building? Rashtra Nirman.
Who is this addressed to?
To you.
To me? Oh my God. that's a very difficult question to answer in such a short span of time, but I can only give a hint that he had a very different perception of what is called nationalism, which if you read his collection of essays on the same title, you'll be able to understand. But there's also this lovely biography of Rabindranath by Krishna Kriplani that I'm going to refer to you. This book explains in very great detail the convergence and divergences between Rabindranath and Mahatma Gandhi. They both were great personalities who respected each other, but also had very serious differences of opinion on the question of the nationalism. There are novels by Rabindranath, especially Gora and Ghore Baire, The Home and the World, that are examples of what he felt was about the nation. But once again, I'd hark back to this, the motto that we believe for our institution, which is Yatra Vishwa Bhavati Eka Niram, because at a time when the nation was fighting for independence, especially political independence, here was a man who apparently was very unpopular because he was singing in the opposite direction. He was talking about world communication and world collaboration. He was talking about a global spirit, and that is probably where we have to try and understand this person having a very, very, very future, sight into what nations should be at a later date. I do not know whether this answers the question exactly, but that's probably how I'd like to see the Rabindranath that I revere, the Rabindranath that I love and admire.
Thank you, Dr. Malik. I'm just glancing through the chat box, and it is full of appreciation, wonderful, mind-blowing, excellent presentation, and all compliments. Unable to see any questions. My dear participants, if you have any questions, you can send in Q&A. We can take up your questions. You can ask anything on Dr. Sanjay Malik's presentation, about the other presentation by Dr. Bangru, Dr. Sanjay Jha, Dr. Achal Pandya. And if you have any questions, we'll take up. Meantime, like I didn't see questions, so I can request our member secretary for.
Achal is raising some question.
Achal, you want to ask some question? Yeah, Achal, please go ahead. Yeah, Achal, you can. I can hear you.
Yeah,
sir, I have a question to Professor Mandeep.
Yeah, please go ahead. I can.
Sir, take one.
Yeah, Shilpi.
Artwork is marked as a sir, Tagore artwork is open marked as a synthesis of
Shilpi. Your question is not clear. Can you repeat it or can you come closer to the speaker? Shilpi, can you hear me? Achal, can you hear me? I think, sir, Achal and Shilpi, their screen is freezed. So, any other question? Achal, Shilpi? Sir, I think there is no question. Achal and Shilpi are unable to ask questions because of some network connectivity. So, sir, would like to say your concluding remarks. Sir, are you online?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Sir, would like to give your concluding remarks.
I think there is no need of a concluding remark after a very, very fine lecture by Dr. Sanjay Kumar Malik. और चूंकि मैं देख रहा था बार बार कुछ हमारे प्रतिभागियों के कमेंट्स थे कि हिंदी में भी बात हो, तो अभी ये थोड़ी सी बात मैं हिंदी में कर देता हूँ. वैसे तो ये पूरा वेबिनार का कुछ हिस्सा हिंदी में भी होता तो मुझे लगता है बहुत सारे प्रतिभागियों को शायद इसमें आसानी होती. तो अगली बार से हम लोग इसका ध्यान रखेंगे. और जो बात रविंद्रनाथ टैगोर और बंगाल स्कूल ऑफ पेंटिंग के बारे में और शांति निकेतन की कला के बारे में आदरणीय डॉक्टर संजय कुमार मलिक जी ने कही है, उसमें सिर्फ मैं यही बात जोड़ना चाहता हूँ, जो हमारे जो कला के संदर्भ में जो विद्यार्थी यहाँ पर प्रशिक्षण प्राप्त कर रहे हैं अलग अलग संस्थानों में, अगर वो इसको देखेंगे तो वो समझेंगे कि ये कितनी बड़ी चुनौतियां हैं और उन चुनौतियों के बीच से अपनी कला का मूल तत्व बचा के रखना, जो ओरिजिनल एसेंस बचा के रखना एक बहुत बड़ी बात थी. जिस युग की वो बात कर रहे थे, वो सारा युग जो था वो यूरोपियन प्रभुत्व का युग था, यूरोपियन डोमिनेंस का युग था पूरे विश्व में. और ये सिर्फ ये जो प्रभुत्व था, ये डोमिनेंस था, ये सिर्फ एक क्षेत्र में हो, राजनीतिक क्षेत्र में हो, ऐसा नहीं होता. क्योंकि राजनीति जब कहीं आती तो सिर्फ राजनीति नहीं आती, वो समाज पर भी प्रभाव डालती है, सोच पर भी प्रभाव डालती है, संस्कृति पर भी प्रभाव डालती है, और वो सबसे बड़ा प्रभाव कला पर डालती है. कला का जहां महत्व है, अगर आप थोड़ा सा पीछे जाएं तो आप देखेंगे कि आज से 1000 साल पहले या आज से 2000 साल पहले की बहुत सारी चीजें जो हमारे बीच में आज भी मौजूद है, वो चीजें हैं क्या? वो दरअसल सब कलाकृति के नमूने हैं. किसी न किसी दृष्टि से व्यक्ति ने अपने आप को एक्सप्रेस किया है, अभिव्यक्त किया है अपनी कलाकृति के माध्यम से. और उसी माध्यम से अपन देख पाते हैं, समझ पाते हैं उस समय का समाज, उस समय के समाज की रचना और उस समय के समाज का मन मानस कैसा था. तो इस दृष्टि से अगर हम सोचें कि जब यूरोपियन डोमिनेंस का जो पूरा काल था, उस यूरोपियन डोमिनेंस के काल के बीच में से पूरे के पूरे एक स्कूल ऑफ पेंटिंग की ऐसी रचना करना, बंगाल स्कूल ऑफ पेंटिंग की रचना करना, जो भारतीय संस्कृति के उस मूल तत्व को कहीं ना कहीं बचा कर रखे, ओरिजिनलिटी ऑफ इंडियन कल्चर. हम देखते हैं अब जो शिल्प के विद्यार्थी होंगे या जिन्होंने मूर्ति कला का अध्ययन किया होगा, वो इस बात को महसूस करेंगे कि कैसे समय के साथ साथ शिल्प का आकार बदलता है, एक्सप्रेशंस छोड़ दीजिए, फीचर्स बदल जाते हैं। तो ये जो फीचर्स बदलना है, जैसे भारत में जो नाक या जो भौहें या जो होंठ की रचना है, वो अगर हम किसी और से इन्फ्लुएंस हो जाएं, तो देखेंगे आप, ये एक समय आया जब हमारे स्कल्पचर्स में यूरोपियन इंप्रेशन आ गया, हमारे फीचर्स यूरोपियन होने लग गए। या कभी जब साउथ ईस्टर्न इन्फ्लुएंस आया, तो साउथ ईस्टर्न फीचर में आपने देखा होगा हमारी चीजें हो गई। तो ये इतना एक लंबा एक्सपीरियंस, लंबा इंप्रेशन पड़ता है। तो इसलिए पेंटिंग को या स्कल्पचर को या एक्सप्रेशन की उस विधा को बचा के रखना जिसमें हमारी संस्कृति, हमारी परंपरा और हमारे अपने परिवेश का हम सही चित्रण कर सकें, ये बहुत बड़ा काम गुरुदेव रविंद्रनाथ टैगोर के नेतृत्व में, उनके मार्गदर्शन में एक पूरा का पूरा बंगाल स्कूल ऑफ पेंटिंग है, जो उनके समय से शुरू हुआ, बाद में कुछ लोगों ने उसे शांतिनिकेतन स्टाइल ऑफ पेंटिंग की तरह से अलग से भी लिया, बंगाल के और भी लोगों ने अलग अलग तरह से उस बात को कहा, और ये बात अब धीरे धीरे एस्टेब्लिश हो गई, एक तरह से कहीं ना कहीं साबित हो गई, सिद्ध हो गई। तो विशेष रूप से आज जो कला के विद्यार्थी हैं, जो आर्ट विजुअल आर्ट का काम कर रहे हैं, जो आगे जाने वाले समय में विजुअल आर्ट का काम कर रहे हैं, उनको दरअसल इस बारे में बहुत गहराई से सोचना होगा कि आज जो वो पेंटिंग, आज जिस चीज की वो निर्मिति करते हैं, कोई कलाकृति हो, चाहे वो स्कल्पचर हो, चाहे वो पेंटिंग हो, वो आज से 50 साल बाद, आज से 100 साल बाद जब वो किसी को दिखेगी, और वो हमेशा दिखेगी, आप हमेशा जान लीजिए कि कोई भी कलाकृति, कोई भी चीज नष्ट नहीं होती, कहीं ना कहीं वो इस आभा मंडल में, इस पूरी प्रकृति में कहीं ना कहीं वो मौजूद रहती है, और वो जहां भी मौजूद रहती है वो आपके काल की और आपकी रचनात्मकता की गवाही देती है। तो इसलिए आप जब भी कोई चीज सृजित करें तो ये सोच के कतई ना करें कि ये सिर्फ हमने अभी के लिए बनाया है, स्वांत सुखाया है, मुझे जैसा समझ में आया मैं, आप हमेशा ये भी सोचें कि आज से 50 साल बाद, आज से 100 साल बाद जो भी लोग रहेंगे वो इससे आपका ही सिर्फ आकलन नहीं करने वाले हैं, वो उससे पूरे के पूरे समाज का, पूरे परिवेश का, पूरी संस्कृति का, पूरी परंपरा का आकलन करने वाले हैं। तो जब ये हमारे अंदर अपनी कला को अभिव्यक्त करने की ये दृष्टि कहीं आ जाती है, तब ही जाके हम श्रेष्ठतम कलाकृतियों का निर्माण कर पाते हैं। ये जो आज प्रदर्शनी जिसका उद्घाटन हुआ और डॉक्टर संजय कुमार मलिक का जितना विद्वत्तापूर्ण व्याख्यान हमें सुनने मिला, ये सब इस बात को भी जोड़ते हैं कि हमारी जो कला की अभिव्यक्ति है, एक्सप्रेशन ऑफ माय आर्ट, उसका बेसिक पर्पस, बेसिक उद्देश्य क्या होना चाहिए और वो भविष्य में जाकर कैसे लोगों के सामने अभिव्यक्त हो, बस इतनी ही बात मैं कहना चाह रहा हूँ। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
धन्यवाद सर, आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। शिल्पी, आप मुझे सुन सकते हो?
हाँ सर।
अच्छा, तो शिल्पी को मैं फॉर्मल वोट ऑफ थैंक्स के लिए इनवाइट करने से पहले मैं कुछ पार्टिसिपेंट्स को कहना चाहूँगा, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आपका अटेंड करने के लिए, और उसके साथ साथ आपके जो सर्टिफिकेट्स हैं वो हम लोग आपकी जो ईमेल आईडी, रजिस्ट्रेशन ईमेल आईडी है, उसके बेसिस पे बना के आपको ईमेल कर दिए जाएंगे। इसकी वेबिनार की रिकॉर्डिंग IGNCA यूट्यूब चैनल पर कुछ दिनों में अपलोड हो जाएगी, आप उसको जो आपके साथी या जो लोग नहीं आज सुन पाए उनको रेफर कर सकते हैं, और उसके साथ साथ जो भी आपकी IGNCA कलेक्शंस को लेके, करुणानिधि कलेक्शंस को लेके जो भी क्वेरीज हैं, आप फील फ्री टू कॉन्टेक्ट अस। लाइब्रेरी फैसिलिटीज को लेके, किसी भी तरह के रिसोर्सेज को लेके, यू आर वेलकम टू रेज योर क्वेश्चंस। नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट माय कोलीग डॉक्टर शिल्पी राय टू प्रपोज अ वर्ड ऑफ थैंक्स।
थैंक यू सर। Good evening all. I take this opportunity to extend a hearty vote of thanks to all of you on behalf of Kalanidhi Division IGNCA. First of all, my profound thanks to Professor Dr. Shuchidanand Joshi, Member Secretary IGNCA. Thanks a lot, sir, for your guidance and inspiration in all our activities. Thanks again, sir, for your gracious presence and today's amazing inaugural speech and concluding speech. Next, my sincere thanks to Professor Dr. Ramesh Gaur, Dean IGNCA and HOD Kalanidhi. Thanks, sir, for your guidance and encouragement in each and every endeavor our division. Next, my special thanks to Professor Sanjay Malik, Principal, Kala Bhavan Vishwabharati, Shanti Niketan. Thanks, sir, for your excellent presentation focusing on painter Tagore in the context of early Indian modern art. Thanks again, sir, for sharing with us some scintillating creation by Tagore from your collections. My thanks to Dr. Sanjay Jha, Deputy Archivist, Culture Archives, IGNCA, Dr. Bangru, Regional Director, Jammu Center, IGNCA, and Dr. Pandya,
associate professor and HOD conservation. I'm sure through your informative presentation, viewers got a glimpse of IGNC's rich cultural resources and how we're preserving those with great care. In fact, IGNC has one of the best conservation lab in India working under Achal sir. Thank you, sir. Once again, my thanks to Dr. Kumar Sanjay Jha, Cultural Archive team, entire Kalanidhi team for presenting this virtual exhibition on such a significant topic highlighting cultural scenario of Bengal from late 18th to 20th century through the work of celebrated painters and photographers from IGNC collections. I also thank other division of IGNC, especially CIL Media Center, publication, Kaladarshana for extending their support in this endeavor. Finally, I thank wonderful viewers for your active participation. Thank you all for you once again and have a nice day. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your wonderful word of thanks. But more than that, you were the you play a very important role in this exhibition.
Thank you, sir.
Hard work in installation, in curation, and making all the arrangements. So you did wonderful work and you deserve more than anybody else. Big thanks. And keep doing it. So thank you all. Thank you, Dr. Malik, for your special presence. And we will look forward to meeting you again and having more collaborative program. Thanks, Sanjay. Thanks, Vangruji, Achal. Thanks, sir, for your always encouraging support and guidance. So we will now take leave and close this webinar closed and declare webinar closed and look forward to meeting you some other. Thank you, participants. All the best. Thank you.